This is Duke University.
Welcome, everybody, and welcome to Transforming Cities Through Innovation, a 2016 Terry Sanford Distinguished Lecture. I'm Kelly Brownell, Dean of the Sanford School of Public Policy. And on behalf of the school, I am pleased to welcome all of you here for a discussion with our special guest, Mayor Mitch Landrieu from the City of New Orleans. Tonight's Terry Sanford Distinguished Lecture was endowed by a gift to the university from the William R. Keenan Charitable Trust in honor of the late Terry Sanford. Sanford was governor of North Carolina, U.S. Senator, and president of Duke University from 1970 to 1985, during which time he established what is now Duke's Sanford School of Public Policy. The purpose of the Sanford Lecture is to bring to campus men and women of the highest personal and professional stature to deliver a lecture to the Duke community. Tonight's distinguished lecture by one of America's most innovative mayors launches Sanford's Innovator-in-Residence program, a three-year pilot program made possible by Barbaralee, Diamonstein-Spielvogel, and Carl Spielvogel, which aims to advance and promote government innovation. We could hardly have a more fitting person to launch this program. The program will bring to campus, for short residencies, public sector leaders who possess a wealth of experience in creating organizations that are adaptive and innovative in addressing the unique barriers to innovation in large bureaucracies and in developing cross-sector partnerships that accelerate problem solving. I'd like to introduce the person to my far left, Sean Riley. We're delighted that Sean, a member of Sanford's Board of Visitors and a Duke parent, and by the way, our Board of Visitors is chaired by Matt Cullinan, who's joined us in the front row over here. Sean has agreed to moderate tonight's conversation and to formally introduce Mayor Landrieu. Sean is the Chief Executive Officer of Lamar Advertising Company, headquartered in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and is a former member of Louisiana House of Representatives. From 1988 to 1996, Sean served as a Democrat in the Louisiana House from District 68. During his tenure, he served as Vice Chair of the Ways and Means Committee and as a member of the Education, Commerce, and Legislative Audit Advisory Committees and as a member of the State Bond Commission. Sean served his state in a variety of capacities and was an appointee to various positions by both Democratic and Republican governors since he left the legislature. He has served on, to name a few, the Louisiana Recovery Authority, which was established to direct the rebuilding of Louisiana after the 2005 hurricanes, and Governor Jindal's Transition Advisory Council on Ethics Reform. Sean has served in leadership positions on numerous nonprofit and community organizations. In 2015, Ernst & Young named Sean as a national finalist for Entrepreneur of the Year. Sean graduated from Harvard in 1984 and from Harvard Law School in 1989. Please welcome Sean Riley and Mayor Mitch Landrieu. Hey, Sean.
Well, thank you for that, Dean Brown. I wasn't expecting that. And what an honor to be here at Sanford. And again, Dean, thank you for letting me do something that's going to be incredibly fun, which is introduce and have a conversation with my dear and long-term friend, Mayor Landrieu. I'm gonna be calling him Mitch, but you should know that we actually call each other seatmate. And obviously with a nickname like that, there's gotta be a story attached. So here it is. Mitch and I were elected to the legislature in Louisiana in 1988. Mitch was 15 at the time, I was 14. Mitch from New Orleans, me from Baton Rouge, and of course, this being Louisiana, there was a wee little bit of nepotism involved. Mitch won the seat formerly held by his sister, and I won the seat formerly held by my dad. So if asked the question, how did you get into public service?
tell them they just run against each other.
Yeah, they did. So we were seatmates for 8 years. And we developed some, again, this being Louisiana, some pretty interesting procedural mechanisms. For example, it was fairly common back in the day for legislative seatmates to vote each other's machine in the other's absence. I kid you not. If Mitch had to get up and greet a constituent, have a cup of coffee, we had this little yardstick with a rubber band on the end, and I could lean forward and hit red or green. And of course, Mitch would do it for me. And I don't know if I was absent more than Mitch or whether I voted his machine more than mine, but I do know this. Mitch had one fantastic voting record. I mean, the kind of record that would propel him to ever greater heights in public service, obviously, Lieutenant Governor of Louisiana, Mayor of New Orleans. And I see the cameras rolling. I'm just joking. I didn't vote Mitch's machine.
I'm not admitting.
Yeah, at least not on anything important. But anyway, without further ado, please welcome my dear friend and one of, I think, America's greatest public servants, Mitch Landrieu.
Thank you, Sean. Thank you.
You want to jump right in?
I'll talk a little bit. Mayor Bell, thank you so much for having us. Mayor Bell and I have been colleagues in the U.S. Conference of Mayors for a long time and have exchanged a lot of thoughts and ideas about how to run cities, so it's great to be here. And Dean, thank you again for having me and for all of you in this beautiful space. It really is a joy to be at Duke, one of the great universities of the world. And I've really been thrilled as I have traveled around the city today just to see how important Duke is, Mr. Mayor, and understand the partnerships that you have with the university that I think is so very important. And then, of course, to my really, really good friend, Sean, and to his lovely wife, Jennifer, and to his beautiful kids, Anna Rowan and Aiden, who are in the back. And we have a student in our midst. I'm really just thrilled and happy to be here and to really kind of talk a little bit about what the future of government looks like, especially as it relates to cities and innovation, because it's going to be where most of the innovation in government takes place in the next couple of years. And Sean and I, although he is one of the great business leaders in the country, and his company does great things, Sean has good bones legislatively and in public policy as well. Sean is one of those rare people that have actually had intensive work both in the government and the business sector and really understands what both of them can do together. And on top of that, when called upon, when Louisiana was in its worst crisis in its history, actually helped lead the Louisiana Recovery Authority. That was the entity whose responsibility it was to put Humpty Dumpty back together again when we suffered the worst man-made disaster in the history of the country. And it wasn't easy lifting at the time. As you may recall, Governor Blanco and President Bush were somewhat at odds. We had many people who had been killed. The city was, for the most part, underwater, as was a good portion of the southern part of the United States of America. And Sean helped lead the effort to not only create the plan to rebuild the area, but to be the liaison between the White House and the state of Louisiana, and has done a great job. And I'm thrilled to be with you.
Well, thank you for that. Yeah.
It is hard to be a good Democrat legislator in Louisiana.
Well, let's jump into that theme of post.
I heard that, Mayor.
Yeah. Let's jump into that theme of sort of post-disaster leadership and innovation. I think it's an appropriate place to start because coming out of Hurricane Katrina, New Orleans got the opportunity to sort of rethink old problems and think about new approaches. And in 2010, you inherited that and stepped in and thought anew. So tell us a little bit about that. What sort of innovative things came out of that disaster?
Well, let me try to paint this picture for you, because it's a hard one to get into your head if you didn't live through it. Most of the time when you go home at night, the breaking news of the day from CNN is something you heard like 8 times during that day, and it's not really breaking news at all. It is breaking news when a Category 4 or 5 hits the place where you live and puts it underwater for a long period of time and basically destroys everything as you know it. Now, that's hard to conceptualize because most of the kind of catastrophes that you see on TV are geographically small, where one part of a community got hurt, the rest of the community couldn't come help stand it up. There are some catastrophic events, like you've seen them across the world, what happened to Haiti when entire populations are displaced. This is what the event was like in New Orleans. We lost 1,800 people, 500,000 homes, 500,000 were hurt, 250,000 were destroyed. That meant gone. In Cameron Parish, which is on the west side of the state, there was not one building in the parish left standing from Hurricane Rita, which happened 3 weeks after. So when I'm telling you devastation, there was nothing there. And it took us, not surprisingly, a long time just to kind of process what had happened and how bad it really was. I mean, this was a catastrophic event that was hard to recover from. We could have never recovered without the help of the American people, so I thank you for everything that each and one of every one of you did as a taxpayer, and also what you did as part of a faith-based community is to come down and to help other people stand up who were in desperate need. We had help from all around the world, so we didn't do this by ourselves. And it did take us, you know, a good 3-4 years to actually figure out that fighting wasn't going to help, because there was a lot of, oh my God, I lost everything that I have. Now somebody's coming to try to take it. People are going to use this as an opportunity to recreate the city. There was class warfare. There was race warfare. There was a lot of that stuff going on. And it became pretty evident, you know, that all of the multinational corporations that came in, all of the philanthropic organizations, that the money that they were pouring into the city was not necessarily getting focused in the right direction. And we had a mayor who was in office that, at the time that the recovery came into his sphere, did not do a great job of encouraging public confidence or directing money in the same places. But at some point in time, the public decided to do something different. It was either because of fatigue or because this was our last chance. And so I ran for office and had the great fortune of getting elected on the weekend that the Saints won the Super Bowl. Now, I think I got elected because nobody was paying attention. And they were much more interested in the fact that the Saints, after having lost every game of their life, could actually, you know, go from worst to best, which turned out, incidentally, to be a great rallying cry for civic engagement, where the public took something that, you know, had been part of their being forever, beaten down over time, never winning, and watched the team go from zero to hero. It really kind of gave the city a spark. My election was literally on the same day. And at that point in the city's pain point, after 4 years of not getting anything done, I think the public just decided to get it together and to understand that we might never have another chance, and if we had this one, we ought to take it. And so what was really interesting about it, because people ask me all the time, do you need a storm or do you need a catastrophic event to completely recreate yourself? I'm not sure that's true, but I can say this, that when you have had a near-death experience in your life, when you've had a family member that is threatened with cancer, or somebody has died from a tragic car accident, or you've been in that pain point, you only have two choices. You got to get up and keep walking, or you got to quit. I mean, and most life or death circumstances don't present themselves to us like that. We had one. We literally had them when people were either going to get rescued or they weren't going to get rescued. There wasn't enough room in the boat. Either we were going to build it back. And we were at that moment where we knew we only had one way to go if we wanted to survive. And so we began to have a community conversation. And we had just somehow gotten to the point through all of our agony, all of our pain, all of our shared misery, and quite frankly, the ability to see beauty when everything looked lost. People did things for each other that you never expect. People walk across the street to greet other people. Folks that you would never communicate with, you did because you had to. Necessity required you to reach out and either help somebody or ask them to help you. That ethos was essential to us getting in a space where we could actually start recreating the city. Now, by this time, a lot of help that came in from the Baton Rouge Area Foundation, the Rockefeller Foundation, kind of started going away because they didn't think we were going to get it together, but there was kind of a new thing. There was a new mayor, there was a new kind of sense in town, and so those folks started showing up again. And we started thinking through, how in the world are we going to build this city back? We have to do it a different way. And in order to do that, we have to do something that I think is very hard, and I think you'll appreciate this. We have to actually look in the mirror at ourselves and get rid of this notion that we were somehow this romantic place that was better than everybody else that never had any problems. We have to look in the mirror, and we had to honestly say to ourselves that on August 28th, which was the night before the storm hit, even though we historically had been a great city, we had ceased to be one, that we had lost our way, that something somewhere before Katrina hit caused us to be where we were today. Let me just give you a data point. In 1960, in the city of New Orleans, we were bigger than Houston and we were bigger than Atlanta. There were 680,000 people that lived in the city in 1960. Now, something evidently happened between 1960 and August 28, 2005, that caused people to leave the city, that caused crime to go up, that caused corruption to flourish, that caused businesses to not work well, to where the night before Katrina, we were down to 460,000 people. In other words, we were a descending city, and we were going in the wrong direction fast. So it took a lot of guts for the people of the city to say, you know what? We do have the best food, we have the best music, we have the best fun, we have the best everything, but something's not right. And we're not going to blame everything we had on Katrina. And now that we have an opportunity to rebuild it, instead of putting it back just like it was, I mean, literally putting the school back, dewatering it, painting it over, covering the plastic, let's just put it back like it was. We actually decided that we were going to recreate the city. And we were going to build it back the way it should have always been had we gotten it right the first time. Now, that's really important, because that takes you to the ability to reconstruct an education system and have a completely new system and completely new buildings. It takes you from having a healthcare delivery system that was centered on one building with an emergency room that did all the primary care for the poor people to having 88 primary healthcare clinics throughout the city that create preventative care. It took you into a public-private partnership in the business community between the city and the businesses. It took you into a recreation department where the private sector and the faith-based community helped. And those kinds of what I call fundamental building blocks that took a long time to put in place, that didn't get you an immediate pat on the back and hurrah because you were taking stuff away, that kind of freedom that the people gave to the leaders with their help has allowed the city to lay what I call a very, very strong foundation and create a virtuous cycle of success that has now made us an ascending city. A city that's got really good health care, a city that's got an education system that actually is really quite good, and it's a model that can be replicated across the country. But it really kind of took that death moment and that near-death experience that the rest of us had to say, you know what, we've got one more chance, and let's not lose it. It caused a lot of conflict. There were a lot of issues that went through it, but essentially, it was the people of New Orleans' decision to be different and wanting to change. While maintaining our historicity and our culture, which again was an interesting thing that allowed us to kind of make the tracks that we've made in the last couple of years.
So let's dig a little deeper.
Okay.
So in 2010, David Osborne of Reinventing Government referred to New Orleans as the least competent city in the country.
That's true.
2010, which about the time you took office.
Yeah.
Fast forward 6 years and POLITICO calls you, I think I'm going to get this right, America's turnaround mayor. So you get there. What needed turning around? And how'd you get it done?
Well, that first of all, it's not fair to say there was a turnaround. There was nothing there. I mean, it really, you know, mostly when you have in a normal fight, well, we just had one in the presidency. Right? So President-elect Trump will take over from President Obama. They're going through this transition. You may like one guy and not like another, but there's a thing there to be transitioned into. There's an actual physical government. And you've got to hire new people, but there's a structure in place. There's a budget process in place. There's somebody knows how many, you know, how many things we own. We had no idea what we had. And the reason was that when the recovery took place, every public teacher was fired in New Orleans, so there literally were no schools. Every public employee was fired, so there were no public employees. The only way that we kept the civil government working was we hired contractors that came out of like nowhere. I didn't know they had people that did this, but they manifest themselves. And they began to kind of, you know, run the civil government at the top. So we had to transition back into, you know, a government that was functional and workable. So, you know, my first order of business, of course, was to set up a competent government. And so I called on people like you and Jenny and a lot of civic leaders to be part of our transition team that would help us think about where the city was, where we need to go, and how to get there. And so I had transition teams on everything, how to pick up garbage, how the police department should work, how to make the sewer and water system work, what should our relationship be with the schools, how are we going to interact with the government. And then I went and found the best people that I could find who knew a lot more than I did about how to run each part of the government. Now, not surprisingly, and I would, all the students, the first thing you should do if you don't know what you're talking about, ask somebody who does. That's a really good rule that you should keep and not assume that you know what you don't know. So I went to the guys that I thought were the best and the gals, best mayors in America. So I got myself to Chicago and I talked to Richard Daley, and then I went to see Mayor Bloomberg, and then I went to go see the mayor of Boston, Tom Menino. And then I called every mayor in America and I said, what am I supposed to do? And the first thing they all told me was hire a good scheduler. They all told me, I said, that's not what I was talking about. They said, no, you're gonna need a good scheduler because everybody wants to see the mayor and you can't talk to everybody and you shouldn't. It was very wise advice, actually. And the second thing they said was hire really competent people who are experts in what they do, not political people. Now, I'm a politician. I was born and raised in the business. And, you know, I know a lot of people in the government and in the private sector. And I decided that I was gonna professionalize the way the city government was run. Now, this city has a city manager. We had to first decide whether we were going to have a city manager form a government or a strong mayor. I opted to stay with the strong mayor. I thought that's what the city needed at the time. And given the way New Orleans is structured vis-a-vis the state, we've historically been a strong mayor model, and I opted to stay with that, and I think it was the right decision. But what I also decided to do, because I wanted to replicate what the best cities in America had done, is create a deputy mayor system. So instead of just having the mayor and then a CEO and then all of these direct reports, after a lot of consultation with Sean and a lot of other people, what I decided to do was to figure out what the city needed expertise in, and then I created a new org chart based on the talent that I could find, and we created a deputy mayor system. And then what I did was I told everybody that we were gonna have a government based on what you know, not who you know. Now, the way it used to work in New Orleans, if you knew the mayor, and you had a friend that could get to the mayor, you could go talk to the mayor. And you would ask the mayor, don't you think we should do this, 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 or this? And the mayor would, through his wisdom and judgment, decide that's what we're gonna do and go tell his department heads to do it, et cetera, et cetera. Now, I'm being very general, and there were a lot of mayors that went before, including my dad, and they may have done stuff a little bit differently. But essentially, what I wanted was nobody to be able to get to me based on relationships. I wanted them to have to come through me to me through ideas. And the only way that could happen is if I made them prove that case to people who knew a lot more than me about budgeting, healthcare, education, whatever, so that by the time it got to me, it was a baked product. And people knew that we were gonna have a higher level of expectation. That's the first thing I did. The second thing I did was I changed the procurement laws by a stroke of a pen, by an executive order, because I could do it, which basically said the mayor's not awarding contracts anymore until it goes through a public process. Now that changes a lot of stuff. And what it means is that whoever wants to show up with the best product and the best price can now come into the city and it's open and transparent and you can compete. And so that changed a lot, because what we made people do, even people that normally did business with the city, is we made them put their best foot forward so the taxpayers were getting a better result. And then the third thing I did, and this was just hard, is we had to balance our budget. Now Sean and I'll speak for you, but Sean and I are both reformers. My theory was, forget about being right, forget about being left. Make the government fast, quick, entrepreneurial, make sure it's appropriately balanced with the private sector, and then figure out a way to get it done and make sure that it's open, transparent, and the taxpayers, you can be accountable to them, essentially. And don't be afraid of breaking a lot of eggs. You've got to fix systems inside of government. So we went to work on that, and I wound up cutting, and part of it is balancing your budget. Not taking in more money than you have, but balancing the budget, which is not easy to do. Because some people that are on the right just cut anything and they don't care. And some people on the left say, just raise taxes and I don't care. No, it's got to measure out. So I had a $100 million hole in a $460 million budget. That's about 20, 22%. That's a lot of cutting, and that hurts a lot. That means real jobs, real people, real programs, which generally speaking create all kinds of crazy backlash. So we tried to do that, and I had to just kind of conceptualize what we were going to do. And I told my team, look, you got about a five-point program. What you want to do is cut with a scalpel, not with a hatchet, you know, or a sledgehammer. Don't do that. Reorganize so it's more efficient and more effective, right? Try to take the savings and put it in things that were emasculated that somehow people had forgotten, and then let it grow. And then after that, and only after that, if we needed more revenue, we'd go to the public. And we just did that over and over and over again in what I would call the hard work of governing, getting there early, staying late, making the hard decisions, not kicking anything down, no kicking any cans down the road, and basically communicating to them that we were going to leave this government better than we found it, and the next mayor and the next city council are going to have a great chance to survive without legacy costs. So get into pension fights. Don't worry about if it's with the unions or not. Get into reforming the police department, getting the reform. They do all the hard stuff because that's what our job is. We're going to do all the hard stuff because all the mayors told me that I talked to, do the hard stuff first. And so just run to the fire. So we just kind of went through that program of hiring a competent group, taking on the toughest issues, fighting all the fights that needed to be fought because the public had our back and they knew that we were trying to do the right thing. And that process has kind of led over time to a government that functions better than the one that we had and is beginning to create that virtuous cycle that you and I talked about a little bit earlier.
Y'all, before you could do anything innovative, you had to change a culture.
Yeah.
That was seemed to be step one.
Yeah, that was hard to do because, you know, it doesn't matter what the philosophy of an organization is, there are entrenched interests. And my observation, even though I'm a change agent, and I thought change would come easy, change is hard. I think it's unnatural. It's almost, right? I mean, I'm always thinking about change. It's not my nature not to change. And I kind of, you know, thought the whole world was like me. But it turns out that it's not. And that change is just really, really hard for us. And changing culture is particularly difficult. Because there may be some people inside an organization that want to change and others that might smother it. My entire ethos when I got there was tear it up. If it doesn't work, tear it up. We can do something different. Now, I had to spend a lot of political capital on this because a lot of the very strong self-interest have a way of influencing governments unless the person at the top protects all the people below them. So I would not let, and this caused a lot of problems. I mean, this was not easy to do. But like the knock on me early on was the mayor's hard to get to. I can't talk to the mayor. He's out of touch. Well, the first two things were right. I was not easy to get to, and I was hard, but I was not out of touch. I was on the street. I was at community meetings. I was with my constituents. I was listening to them. The people that could not get to me were people that wanted to cut a deal. The people that wanted to go around the system that I had set up to protect myself from making a bad decision. So let me drill down on that a little bit. You know, it's hard to say no to your friends when they're sitting in front of you. It's not as hard to say no to them once they've talked to people that know, and on the piece of paper, you can show them the scores, and they didn't measure up. It's not quite as hard after that, because then they have to admit, well, you're giving it to me because you know me. And so if you have a competent group of people working for you, you have an open, transparent system, and if you honor that process and you back it up, and this is hard because a lot of people yelling and screaming, and you don't let anybody get in between you and direct reports, which I never do, all of a sudden you can start making really good decisions. And when you do that and you get rewarded, the public begins to understand that it's a better way. Now, it's not a sacrosanct process. It's not perfect because we're dealing with human beings, but that was a culture change, and that took at least a couple years.
Well, let's see, you're celebrating as a city the 300th?
Our 300th anniversary.
What do you call that, by the way? That's a
tricentennial.
Tricentennial?
That's a long, it's hard to spell.
Yeah, in the corporate world, we call it corporate culture, but that's 300 years of culture.
That's 300.
You've got to change.
Well, you know, if you think about it, from that perspective, if you want to broaden it out, not talking about the culture of City Hall, but the culture of the city, New Orleans is an awesome city. I mean, we got really, really, really good bones, as people would say. If you've ever walked into my city, you know you walked into a special place. We were here before the United States was here. We were a multicultural port. We were actually the economic engine of that area of the country back in the day. we were very earthy people all the time and always liked to have a good time. We like to walk slow, we like to talk slow, we like to eat a lot, we like music, and we like to drink. And we like to have fellowship. And that's fine, that's really good. Now, all of those things that I just told you are inconsistent with a very fast, knowledge-based economy that's driven by technology, okay? You with me? So, you remember in my first soliloquy, I told you that we had to balance a couple of things, hanging on to those things that were part of us while simultaneously preparing ourselves to be part of a 21st century knowledge-based economy. And those things clash from time to time. Now, my personality is a little bit different from what you would see in New Orleans. I like to go fast. I like to do a lot of things, you know, and I like to just kind of get it done. And I'm not good at relaxation. It's not like my strong suit. And so to a certain extent, my personality actually clashes with what you would see. I kind of belong on the streets of New York or Chicago. I mean, I don't like waiting 5 minutes to get a cup of coffee. I want it like in 10 seconds and I want to roll. And so that kind of sense of urgency and that need to go faster, further, and the need to get the city ready to compete, because one of the things that mayors get, first of all, I get to talk to everybody. If I invite you to my office, people generally, even if they don't like you, will come. I get to get in almost any door that I want to get in. And so I get to talk to lots of people. I get to travel around, so I get to see a lot. And if part of my job, people ask me what I do, you know, I'm kind of an Indian scout, I'm a garbage man, I fix street lights, I fill potholes, that's kind of what I do. But when I'm being an Indian scout and I'm listening to what's going on around the country, you know, you can actually come home and say, you know, I know we've been here longer than anybody else, but you know, there's a whole world out there and they do things different. And we might think about that. It's called the best practice, right? That's not the name of an omelet at Commander's Palace. All right, it is a thing, you know, that somebody does better than us. I know we think we're better than everybody else, but they're better than us in some places. And the second thing that we had to do is we had to accept help from the outside. Now, Sean knows this because the city that he's from, Baton Rouge, is as parochial as New Orleans. It's like we can't learn anything from Chicago. We can't learn anything from Duke. We can't learn. Well, no, we can't. We can learn a lot. And what happened is when Katrina hit, all these kind of alien people, y'all would fall into that category, came into our city, right, and started talking about different stuff that we never heard of, and we had to learn how to receive from other folks possibilities that we never existed before. Now, trying to take that and meld that with, well, don't let those people take our culture. Don't let those people, you know, take our music. Don't let those people who are coming, those Yankees and whatever, coming down here. And I had to explain to them. I would say, baby, listen to me. I said, the chances of that person changing you before you got them to eat your gumbo is slim to none. All right, you got no chance of changing the culture of New Orleans if you come. But the people of New Orleans were scared about that. And so, again, when you're thinking about what you want to be and you want to hold on to what you had, it's hard to just let go of your bad stuff because you're afraid you're going to let go of your good stuff too. And that's not easy to do. And I think that we've navigated it pretty well, but I would have to say that after 7 years, you can see everybody falling back into their old patterns of complaining about little things. See, the good thing that I got the benefit of is unless it was a really, really big thing, in the first couple years, not too many complaints. Like if the street lamp went out or the pothole, now my mother calls me about street lots and potholes, right? Because we're kind of easing back into that kind of ho-hum, regular thing taken for granted, that all the things that we've produced are going to sustain themselves over time. That is a very dangerous place to let yourself be. Yeah, I think, if I might, this last round of elections surprised a lot of people, right? And you can think about taking for granted that the world's going to keep going in one direction. It could just the next day turn around and go the other way. And I would say the price of freedom is constant vigilance, and you got to show up. And governing is hard work, not for the faint of heart. And it takes a lot of courage, and it takes a lot of investment, and it takes, and I want to say this to you, and I want you to hear me clearly, sacrifice. Okay, sacrifice as distinguished from investment in. See, an investment is something that you put something that you own in, hoping to get a better return back, if it's a good investment. That's an investment. All right, a sacrifice is giving somebody something that hurts, knowing you're never, ever going to get it back, so that they can have it better than you did. That's what a sacrifice is. So when you tell the people you're going to sacrifice, it means you're going to pay more, you're going to get less, you're going to wait longer, and that's the price of creating a new city. Now, getting everybody there, as opposed to an investment, is not easy, because not everybody necessarily agrees. And that's a challenge in and of itself. And if you can keep everybody kind of on the sacrifice side and not so much on the investment side, you got a better chance of doing more complicated, difficult things.
So I'm going to quickly tick off some wins since Katrina, just in the policy front. Mitch took what was a really horrible public housing system, brought it back on a new model, not the centralized stack 'em and rack 'em, but more of a mixed-use, mixed-income development, real successful. The public school system is the largest charter school system in the country and universally recognized as successful. And as Mitch mentioned, we used to have a centralized healthcare system where virtually anyone that was uninsured walked into the emergency room for whatever. They had to get there and then they had to wait. And now we have clinics out in the neighborhood that are doing good primary and preventative care. So some big wins. So I got to hit you with the hard one, the one we haven't won yet. Just this weekend, there was another mass shooting in the French Quarter. It's seemingly a daily occurrence. It seems intractable. The violence, the homicides, the bloodshed. What can we do about it?
Well, first of all, the three big wins, before we get to the hard stuff, were enormously difficult,
yeah,
and fall into the category that I've spoke about theory and practice. So I love this. My sister used to be a United States Senator, so I can say this. Members of Congress and senators govern in theory and in space. Mayors govern in real time and reality. So when they talk about housing, essentially that idea makes itself down to the ground on a street in New Orleans with a dwelling, with a human being in it. And what it looks like and how it works is really important. Same thing with healthcare. We're gonna have a big fight about the Affordable Care Act and the impact that it has. And people can talk theoretically all they want. Before all of that stuff happened in New Orleans, if you were poor and you didn't have insurance and your baby boy got an earache and you worked in the hospitality industry in an hourly job, you had to go to the emergency room. And you know what? If there was a shooting like we had last night, and this actually happened, I'll tell you the other side of this story, and you happen to sit there and you're gonna get triaged behind all the trauma victims that are coming in, guess what? Your kid's gonna get sicker and you're gonna lose your job. That's exactly the system that we had before. Now we have 88 primary healthcare clinics. So as people start thinking about this Affordable Care Act thing, if as Americans we believe that everybody ought to have access to affordable health care, I essentially don't really care how they do it, as long as we can provide adequate affordable health care to people and they can be happy. So in New Orleans now, if you think about it, laying the foundations, in order to at least do well, you got to be healthy, right? You have to have a good education, and you have to kind of be in an environment where you can actually thrive. And New Orleans has built those building blocks back. Now, Sean raised really the most difficult issue, the one that we all in this country have to talk about and confront. President-elect Trump said that cities were hell holes. They were awful places to live. That's demonstrably not true. That cities in America right now, there are 18,000 of them, right? There are a whole bucket load of them that have 30,000 or more, and there are a bucket load of us that are bigger than that, from 350,000 to New York, Chicago, 8 million, where most of the world in the United States live. 80% of the people in this country live in cities, and those that don't, most of the other ones work in cities, and they are the places of gorgeous universities like this, the biggest businesses, all kinds of great stuff. But it is true that in some neighborhoods, in some of the cities in America, you got really, really serious problems that are the result of, caused by, part of broken families, poverty, no jobs, a culture that has developed around nobody's going to protect me, so I'm going to protect myself. And we've got plenty of that in New Orleans. We also have it all over the country. But if you don't look, it's just something that you don't really have to see unless you watch TV at night. But you got it in a neighborhood near you. You got it here. As a matter of fact, the mayor had to leave this meeting to go to a episode that they had in the city last week with a police-involved shooting. You saw the episodes in Sean's hometown of Baton Rouge. You saw the police shootings in Dallas. You saw Orlando. You remember Sandy Hook. You remember Phoenix. You remember Fort Hood. You remember all of it. So I'll give you a national view, then I'll go to New Orleans because that's my responsibility. But in your country, since 1980, over approximately 630,000, that's a big number, right?
Say that again.
630,000 people have been killed on the streets of America. That's a lot of people. So you might ask yourself, well, how many people is that? That's more American soldiers that were killed in all, underline that, capitalize it, all of the wars of the 20th century and in the first couple years. Now, that's a big number. Now, New Orleans has always been a dangerous place since our inception. It's like part of our DNA. When we started fighting, when the dueling happened, we evidently liked it and we kept doing it. And that iteration of violence has plagued individuals in America since the beginning of time, and it continues to do so. Now, there's some good news on this front, if numbers matter. And, you know, one murder is too many for the person, obviously, that got killed in the family. But in 1996, when the country decided to address this as a nation, when the federal, state, and local governments decided this was a real problem and we wanted to address it together, President Clinton was in office at the time, and they did the 100,000 cops program. They not only hired police officers, they also invested a lot of money in prevention programs, weed and seed programs to the U.S. attorneys. They did a bucket load of stuff. It was also the time when they overstepped and started working on the three strikes, you're out. So they kind of got half of it right, and they got the other half of it wrong, if history is a guide to that. But what has happened since then is you've had negative and positive consequences. On the negative side, you've had the mass incarceration piece, which has not succeeded. But on the positive side, you had community policing. The consequence was negative and positive. You had more people in jail that should have been for the wrong kind of offenses, not the right people for the bad things that they did, which has caused this mass incarceration problem that we should all really look at. But on the positive side, it reduced the good part of it, reduced the murder rate in America in half and cut the crime rate in half. What you've seen in the last couple of years, though, is an uptick of about 5 to 7%, and the public less accepting of even minimal increases because of social media and a bucket load of things. So you have an America that is really afraid, but not willing to put the resources in place. So in New Orleans, when I got there, I can't honestly say that I approached this from a systemic point of view, although I was doing that. The federal government came in, and we needed to put our police department under the consent decree because a few of our officers did something really bad during Katrina. The police department had fallen apart, and we needed to fix it. And so I invited the Justice Department in to do systemic reform in the police department. They also came in and were doing systemic reform in the jail system to get rid of mass incarceration. We had 7,000 people in jail before. We have 1,700 now. And then we're reorganizing where those other folks go. So that piece is getting done. And we're working really hard to make sure that we figure out how to keep the streets safe. But that murder issue that I told you about before just bothers me to no end. And this is why it bothers me. My city is majority African American. My city is more poor than it is rich. We have a lot of beautiful things about our city, but I got way too many kids killing kids in my city. And I made an assumption that I am not sure is accurate anymore, which is if I could tell you about it and I could show you a picture, then you would think it's so bad that you would demand that it changes. And that has not happened. I have made this my cause to stop young kids from killing young kids, because here's the number. No matter what the murder rate is or the murder number is in America, the statistics work out the same way. Young African-American men between 16 and 25, 28, are about 2 to 3% of the population of America, but they are 40% of the victims of murder. And the story is always the same. It's the same exact story, no matter what city you're in, no matter what, where you are, and it happens to me on my low phone every day, I get it. My police chief texts me, and he'll say something like, "Mayor, I'm sorry to inform you that last night in such and such neighborhood, shots rang out. Police arrived at the scene shortly thereafter. On the ground was an African-American male between the ages of 16 and 28, put an age on it. There are no witnesses," every day, over and over and over again. And this year, probably 170 people will be killed on the streets of the city of New Orleans. Now, it's dramatically lower than it was in 1996. It's 40-50% lower, and it's actually 20% lower than when I got in office, because we have programs that are helping. But ostensibly, that number reflects to you that we haven't really dented the real cultural problem, what I call the culture of violence. And so we have been struggling with this, and we have tried everything that you can try, front end, back end, hardcore law enforcement, early childhood education, mental health, substance. We've tried everything. And we have not yet put a dent in it. Now, my view of that is it's because the country hasn't really focused in on it. We haven't said it's a national crisis. It requires a national response. It requires a robust participation from federal, state, and local officials. And people have been left to their own devices. But let me tell you something. These kids are really smart. You go talk to these young men. These guys are not bereft of knowledge. These kids are like, "Mayor, out here, it's kill or be killed. We can't trust the police. We're certainly not going to get disrespected." And they feel like they've been forsaken. This whole iteration after the race about the white middle class feeling left, that kind of a dystopia that you sense that is real, that kind of being left behind, nobody's forgotten us, the free trade deals have thought about the elite but didn't think about us, that same ethos that you hear from poor white Americans in rural towns, you hear the exact same story from poor young African-American men in the urban centers. It's the same story. And the country has somehow decided that we're going to keep each other apart racially or geographically by rural, urban, instead of finding the core thing that's bothering, right, both men and women in an economic stratosphere. And they're saying the same thing, but they're saying it to different people so nobody can hear them. I think they're both connected. And I think the country, I think it's a solvable problem, but I don't think we're anywhere close to getting to where we need to be in terms of resources, focus, and time. And then finally, I think you have to see it like a public health threat as much as a public safety threat. So you can't just arrest your way out of this problem. This is like a virus. It's like Ebola. It's like Zika. That's what violence is. It's just a virus. You have to interrupt it. But the interruption takes a long time and a lot of patience and a lot of stick-to-itiveness. And, unfortunately, we're not where I want to be. And you have a beautiful week in New Orleans with hundreds of thousands of people came for family reunions. We had the Bayou Classic, we had the Saints game, and literally hundreds of thousands of people enjoyed one of the great cities of the world until 1:30, when two boys, who were not from New Orleans, by the way, they were from Lafayette or Baton Rouge somewhere, but they weren't from New Orleans, but they came to New Orleans to have fun, had continued a fight that they had in Lafayette a couple weeks ago, pulled out a gun, and without any respect for anybody's life, much less their own, or personal responsibility, shot each other in a crowd and hit 10 people. One of the kids they hit was a 25-year-old kid that lived in Baton Rouge that had been educated at NOCA, the New Orleans Center for Creative Art, the best art school in the country. And he had just turned the corner to go see his brother, and he caught a bullet right here in his jugular vein and he died. So the chief and I, after going out to the scene and being out there at 3 o'clock in the morning, went to the hospital. It's a true story based on what I just told you. And we're talking to family members and friends of the victims that had been shot. And there was a guy sitting with his mother in a corner. And I said, "Did you have somebody that got shot?" He goes, "No, I have a migraine headache." And I said, "Really?" And I said, you know they're going to triage you, right? And you're going to be here for a long time. I don't know why he didn't go to one of our clinics. But it was harking back to the days when it originally happened. Look, I would say this to you. I have been tooting this horn for a long time. And I've taken a picture of every kid that's been killed before and after he's gotten killed. I have them in books in my office, a big red books. I have 12 of them because now about 1,100 people have been killed in the city since I've been mayor. And by the way, this is half of what it used to be, 1,100 people. That's a lot of people. And I've been to a lot of funerals, way more than I want to be, and consoled mothers and fathers and sisters and brothers and aunts and uncles. And I kind of thought that if I showed the world these pictures, we would stop. And we didn't. And we have it. I don't know what conclusions to draw from that. except that it's not a priority, or they're disposable, or they're not that meaningful, because when things bother us, like a war in Iraq, a terrorist attack, things of that nature, you know, we stop and we pay attention and we fix it. We haven't done it here. So I haven't, I'm going to stop myself from drawing a conclusion about it, because I don't want to go there yet. I'm going to keep trying to find a solution to it. And if I find it, then, I mean, of course, we'll share everything we have with the rest of America. I think it's a national catastrophe. I think it's an embarrassment. I think it's wrong. And quite frankly, I think that if we can find the answer to this, because it's so hard, there's almost nothing that we can't do, which is why I'm continuing to knock my head against the wall and hope that at some point in time we get there before we lose somebody else.
So Mitch is a huge thought leader on this issue, and it's not only hard, it's numbing. And, you know, because it's a constant drumbeat, and you see it in the headlines every day, and if you get numb to it, you stop seeing it, and there's an awful lot of politicians that aren't seeing it, and Mitch, we owe you for seeing it and making us see it, because the numbers are astounding.
Yeah.
They really are.
Well, this is a little bit of a sensitive example, but I'll give it to you anyway. We had a famous football player that was killed in New Orleans a couple of months ago, Will Smith. He was a beloved Saints fan. He and his wife and some of his friends had gone to what was a French Quarter festival. We have those like every day in New Orleans, if you'd like to come to one. And it was really good. But he was on Magazine Street, which is one of our really nice thoroughfares with lots of wonderful things. And he was driving down the street, and he bumped into the back of somebody's car. And then he went around him, and then the guy bumped into the back of his car. And I'm giving you general facts now so as not to get involved, because there's a murder trial going on right now. But generally, they both got out of the cars, and they both had guns. And at the end of the altercation, Will Smith was dead. The other guy got arrested. But it's an interesting situation where both men get out of the car with guns, and then one of them is dead. I can tell you that when Will Smith was killed, everything stopped. I mean, everything in the city stopped. It was a famous football player. It was a terrible incident. But it was a national news story. And good for a good 2 or 3 weeks. You know, people talked about that. When one of the airlines went down, you know, and 200 people were killed, there was a story on CNN every day, all the time. I can tell you, like today, 40 people got killed on the streets of America, and you never heard about any of it. You know, as soon as New Orleans was on the top of the news yesterday, Ohio State was on it today, Charlotte was on it last week, and then Kentucky, in Louisville, Kentucky, it was a couple weeks ago on Thanksgiving, and it'll keep going on and on and on, but nobody actually really stops and does like a 4-day thing when somebody has a Twitter attack. Y'all know who I'm talking about? Yeah. You didn't catch that? You were slow?
I'm
like 4 days on the Twitter, we'll have 2 or 3 days on the Twitter, thing, but not on this. Because it just goes on and on and on and on. And I think it's showing this as it gets numbing, but I do think you gotta stop on this. It is so, I can't even tell you, when you actually dig down into, it's not just that somebody lost their life. Other kids saw them get shot. Their parents have to bury them. The loss of what that person was gonna produce, the amount of money that you spend on the person that killed them, the debilitating impact that it has. I absolutely assure you that people in the United States of America that live in certain neighborhoods have post-traumatic stress disorder from the levels of violence that they have that make them less productive. It's damaging to the country. And the sickness of it is that this is a fixable problem. You know it's fixable. Why do you know it's fixable? Because it hasn't always been this way, right? Didn't we used to have the mob and all that stuff way back in the day, right? Didn't we used to have the Wild West? We had all that stuff. We had iterations of violence. We fixed them. But you gotta have something that interrupts it. And Dean, this would be a great project for all you smart kids that are getting your MPPs. Start thinking about how you eradicate violence on the streets of America. And by the way, it's not just about guns, although guns are a part of it. But as soon as you start talking about assault rifles, I will tell you this, that 98% of the incidents that I just told you about happened with a handgun, not an assault rifle. So I'm not eschewing that argument one way or the other. I'm a Second Amendment. I believe in the Second Amendment, but I also believe in reasonable restrictions, like every constitutional amendment would have. But this is not just about guns. This is about a lot more than that, which is not to say don't talk about guns. It's just that if you do, you got to talk about this thing from beginning to end.
All right, last question, and it's the one we can't avoid. It's the Trump question. You brought up the tweeter.
I did, tweeter in chief.
All right, so here we go.
He should stop doing that.
Here we go.
He should. It's not a wise thing for the president.
All right, so next year.
A lot of room for misinterpretation in a tweet, right?
Yeah. So next year, you're going to be president of the U.S. Congress of Mayors.
I am.
So let's think about this for a minute. Hillary Clinton won virtually every city, virtually every urban center. 500 counties. Donald Trump won 3,500 counties, rural areas.
Yeah.
Part of your job.
And she got 2 million more votes than he did.
Exactly. And part of your job is going to be as liaison from the Conference of Mayors to the federal government. How's that going to work, Mitch? How are we going to do that one?
I'm going to try to do it with elegance and grace. You've seen, I have really struggled with that. You know, this election put me down for a while. I was, first of all, surprised by the outcome. I was not happy with the outcome. I was not for Mr. Trump. As much as I was for Hillary Clinton, I was not for him. It was a double whammy. I don't appreciate his temperament. I don't necessarily like his judgment. I don't like his use of rhetoric, and I don't like his vision. I don't like his pathway of division, and I don't like his vision for America as a general rule, just to start off.
Sounds like the basis for a good working relationship.
Having said that, so that people are clear about where I'm coming from, he is the president-elect. And he will be the president of the United States. And we only have one president at a time. No matter what he does, the republic will survive him, I think. I think it's uncertain about what he's going to do because he is uncertain. Number one, I don't think he knows. I don't buy that he knows and he's just going to tell us later. Like the secret plan on ISIS, I don't buy that. I think he doesn't know. I think he gives himself a lot of room to change his mind. He has demonstrated a mental acuity. In other words, he's smart and he's very malleable. And as you can see from comments that he's made, he can change on a dime. Now, if he does that and makes a good decision and sticks with what he said, that's not a bad thing. But if he continues to change on a dime, that's not good in terms of developing a policy that actually works its way down to the ground. So I think all of us are hopeful. I certainly am, because I am by nature, I'm hopeful. By choice, I'm optimistic. And that's important because it guides what direction you want to go in. So I'm hopeful that he is going, that the weight of the office, well, let me just say this personally. When I stepped into the mayor's office, I probably had more government experience than anybody that had ever run for that office. I had been in office for 22 years, and I went back and looked at all the other mayors that had run, and not many people had that level of experience. So I kind of figured I knew what I was doing. I was wrong. You know, when you're sitting in a job like, and I do think besides the presidency, mayor of a major city is the next toughest job, with all due respect to the senators and to the congressmen and even to the governors, because you're so responsible and you have so much and things are coming at you so fast. If you're in a catastrophic city and you're in a big city like New York or Los Angeles or Chicago, and in instances like New Orleans, it's a tough job. And you gotta have a sticking pole. You have to have some stability. You have to have stick-to-itiveness. You have to be in a position, although I'm not always good at this, of having good temperament, because it's a good idea to lose your temper from time to time. It's a good motivator. But you just can't do it too much, and you can't do it at the wrong time. And I failed on that too, but it's a good principle to remember. You know, you hope that the weight of the office will force him into a more thoughtful place. That's what everybody's hope is. The transition hasn't shown that, you know, to be the case as of yet, but you still have to hope that he's going to do that. So that's that. And then finally, As the president of the U.S. Conference of Mayors, I'm not a lone wolf. I represent all the mayors of America, and we're a bipartisan organization. So we will try to find common ground with President Trump and with Congress. And quite frankly, even though I'm not optimistic that the politics will get us there, if you were just a thinking person and you couldn't be a winner or a loser, you can see you could see a deal on immigration forming if people were thoughtful and wanted to get someplace. The wall's not going to happen. I don't think the wall's going to happen. I think that there may be a little wall somewhere. There might be like a little fence. I just think the wall's not going to happen. I think securing the border through better border enforcement is going to happen, and I think it can happen, and there's technology and manpower that you can do to do that. I don't think 11 million people are getting deported. I don't think that that's going to happen, and I think everybody knows that that's not going to happen. I do think that if there are people here illegally that are committing crimes and putting people at risk, that those people can be arrested and can be deported, and I think that can happen. And then I think there can be a pathway to citizenship. I mean, that's the outline. I'll bet you that if you frame that up, 70% of the American citizens would say, you know what, I think that works, so why don't we do that? I think there's a deal to be had on infrastructure. I think it is absolutely true that we have been outclassed and outpaced by China and India on infrastructure. Now, every city in America, every state in America needs better bridges, better roads, better airports, better ports, and shame on us for allowing ourselves to get so far behind. Now, everybody can agree on this except the Heritage Foundation. And that's important because the Heritage Foundation is the intellectual godfather of a good portion, at least 25% of the House of Representatives. They don't believe that investment of infrastructure produces economic growth. Everybody else in America thinks they do. So 70% of people in America would agree that investments in the nation's infrastructure is going to put people back to work, affect the crime rate because you're going to create worker training programs and make America more competitive overseas. Now, whether or not they can translate that into getting the House of Representatives to vote for a reasonable infrastructure plan that is of the right number, somewhere in the $1 trillion number, $800 to $1 trillion, and paid for appropriately, so it's not just tax credits that are moving money to people that don't necessarily need it, you can actually help rebuild the middle class by rebuilding America. Just those two things, you can find substantial common ground. And I also believe that you can find common ground on criminal justice reform. Newt Gingrich and Cory Booker, two people on the opposite extreme, are talking about the need to make sure that we arrest the right people, not the wrong people, to make sure that when we attach sentences to people, we do it in the right way, that we don't use the prisons as mental health farms, which is what we're doing now in substance abuse treatment centers, which cost way too much money and don't solve the problem. Those three things, it seems to me that there is a consensus in America on getting done. Now, I say I'm not sure about the politics because you know Congress, the way the legislative districts are confected, do not really adequately represent the wholeness of the constituencies that would say yes to those things because they're broken down in ways that don't give those individual congressmen incentives to do those things, and that's a shame. Because I think 75% of the country believes in those three things, and there is a structure in place that if you needed to get to yes, you could get to. And I would proffer this offer to Congress. It's a little bit bold, but I'll make it. That if you gave me 15 governors, and you can split the seventh in half between a Republican and a Democrat, and you made it even, and you gave me 15 mayors, and you gave us those three issues, I'll bet you within 30 days we could come out with an answer, and if you polled it, 70% of America would be for it. We would get to an answer quick. Now, whether Congress actually had the courage to pass it is a completely different story. So you see that on the debt thing that they're working on. But we could get there because the answer is not the problem. It's a political will. And I don't think that they have it. I'm hope that they find a way. And I'll say this as a challenge, or at least just as an offer to the members of Congress. You know, you can't say that you didn't have the ability to do it. You got the presidency, you got the House, and you got the Senate. You need to deliver. I want to see a lower unemployment rate. I want to see an immigration system that works. I want to see a healthcare system that provides cheaper and better, way better, hugely better healthcare to the American people. I want to see growth in the economy that exceeds 2%. I want to see a stock market that goes from 8,000 to 19,000 in 4 years. You bring that home, you've had a successful run. You don't bring that home, then I would just say you didn't put your money where your mouth is. And so we're going to engage and work with them when we can work with them, and then we're going to be very forceful and thoughtful about what's best for America, That's the thing that you need to keep in mind. And I will say this to end, because I've spoken too long on this. I do think that there are a lot of forgotten Americans. And they're white, and they're black, and they're rural, and they're urban. And that income divide that we have is the manifestation of that. And a country divided itself against itself cannot stand. The country will not sustain itself if we remain divided. But the division is not racial. That's not what the division is. It's a class division that we have got to fit, and we've got to get back to supporting working men and women, and we've got to make sure that the least among us actually has a fighting chance if the country's going to survive.
So great. So opportunities for cities with the new administration. I'm hearing the rub is immigration. New Orleans, by the way, is a sanctuary city. And I'm hearing we got opportunities in infrastructure, opportunities in criminal justice. 2 out of 3 ain't bad.
Right. Well, we're actually not a sanctuary city.
I thought we were a sanctuary city.
They first of all, in this fight, this is a mind-numbingly ignorant fight in this way. There is actually no such thing as a sanctuary city. Do you know that?
I didn't know that.
You see that? See, I taught you one thing since we've been
over. More than one, Mitch, more than
there one. Is no, this is what's inane about this particular fight. Of all the things that you could fight about in immigration, I mean, you pick this one. It's an inane argument. There is no such thing in the law, as we speak, in the federal. Any lawyers in here? You got to have a lawyer. I'm the only lawyer in the room. There's something called the Code of Federal Regulations. When Congress passes an act, it then, you know, somebody's got to enforce it. This would go to Homeland Security. They would have to make rules and regulations. They'd have to put it in a book so people would know what the law is, right? Because it's got to be written down to make people follow it. There is no thing called a sanctuary city is defined as blah, 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 blah. It doesn't exist. Sanctuary cities, the moniker started when churches decided to give sanctuary to immigrants and other people that needed help and lifting them up, as the Pope would say that you should do if you were a good Catholic or you try to be like I am, or, you know, your rabbi told you, you know, that which you do to the least of my brothers, so you do unto me. Is that familiar to anybody? Should be. But when the churches started doing that and taking care of the people, of course, the other side took that and turned it into a bad thing, which meant you were harboring criminals who were killing people. And they used the unfortunate example of the family in Northern California. And they said to cities, well, if you do that, we're going to take all the federal funds away from you. And people said, well, like, specifically do what? What specifically thing are you talking about? And so we don't know what President-elect Trump's really theory of immigration is when he says we don't want you to be a sanctuary city. Does that mean we don't want you to feed people that are hungry and ask them first if you're an immigrant? If you are, you can't have the Campbell soup. If you're not, you can have the beef and the potatoes, all right? So one of the issues that law enforcement has is that the police departments are responsible for taking care of protecting and serving people. So I'll give you an example from the police chiefs. If there is a really terrible bout of domestic violence and the police come to the scene and they ask the woman who has called to make the complaint and they have to ask her, are you legal or illegal? She's never going to call the police and she's going to get killed. So they can't protect and serve. We don't really have the luxury. If someone's lying on the street and they're dying, we have to take them to the emergency room to get taken care of. You don't get to say, are you an immigrant? Oh, I'm sorry, if you are, you get to die. That's not the way it works in real time and in reality. Remember I told you that they govern in theory and in space? In real time and in reality, you're dealing with real human beings. Now, if there is a shooting, and I'm the police chief and you're the shooter, and I show up and I arrest you because you have your gun, and it turns out you're an illegal immigrant, you're getting deported. That's just the way it's going to work. You're going to go into a jail. ICE is going to get notified. ICE is the immigration unit that handles this thing. They're going to get notified that you're there. They're going to have an opportunity to come pick you up. And then they should take you into their custody so that the federal government then pays the bill and puts you in an immigration order. And they should deport you if you're a violent criminal. And something's getting lost in the translation there, because what they want is local police departments to stop responding to emergencies, stop responding to shootings, and become the deportation force for the federal government. Well, just as a matter of political comity, that's the federal government's responsibility. So if they wanted us to do that, and we agreed that we should do that, then what they would do is help us hire a lot of people who would do that. Not doing that is what's called an unfunded mandate. That's like, you do something that I tell you to do, and I'm not going to give you the resources to do it. Well, it's a zero-sum game in cities. What you spend your time doing here you can't spend your time doing here. If you have to balance your budget and you spend money on that, you can't teach a kid how to swim. And so mayors of America are going to bring some reality, hopefully, to the discussion about what it is that they want to do. So I'll end with this, and I gave the dean this earlier. Somebody in Congress would respond to this this concept of a wall, like, we should build the wall because we want to secure the border. And then somebody on the other side would say, no, a wall is not friendly. You should read Robert Frost. Don't build walls. All right? That's what the extent of that discussion would be. If you asked a mayor, you think we should build a wall, we may have ideological feelings about it, but normally a mayor's mind would go first to this. Well, how long does a wall have to be? And how high does it have to be? And how wide does it have to be? And what kind of material are you going to build it with? And how much money is it going to cost? And how long is it going to take? And who's supposed to build the wall? And when am I supposed to start? And when am I supposed to finish? And then after you answered all those questions, then you would say, wow, is that really a good idea? Is it necessary? Is that like a better way to do that? Or is that wall just a symbol? Because there might be a better way to do that. Mayors would be thinking practically like that before we even got into an ideological fight about your left and your right. And we approach every issue like that because our job is to actually get something done, not just to talk about it. Congress talks a lot and doesn't get anything done. And that's why the American people are frustrated. And they get really, because they hear all these fights and all these debates. Y'all remember when President Obama was in office that every like couple of months they had a fight about raising the debt ceiling? They were gonna shut the government down because they were gonna borrow money? I would venture a bet you will not hear that when President-elect Trump decides that he wants to invest $1 trillion in infrastructure and has to blow the debt through the roof. You won't hear one thing. You know what else you won't hear? You won't hear Jason Chaffetz or Daryl Issa. These are two guys that run committees and investigate you if you look crooked, if you're a Democrat. They won't initiate one investigation. They won't do it. And so that's why the country, who are not like ideological on one side or the other, that don't hate Hillary or don't like Donald, they were like, well, okay, well, how does this really, really work? Or does it really matter? Is there any integrity in governing? What the country wants to see is a solution, a common sense solution to a problem, and they want to see things getting done. That's what they want. And if this next administration does that, they're going to be great. And if they don't do it, they're not going to be great because the public is at a point where they're like, I want to see something happen. And the public's the boss. They work for us. We don't work for them. And that's what kind of accountability and demand they're going to put. And I would ask everybody to be very aggressive and demand a lot from now, the first unified government that we have had in America for a long, long time. So it's going to be very, very hard. And Sean and I worked for a governor who was our friend that spent a lot of time criticizing Washington for whatever happened in Louisiana. None of that anymore. I mean, they got it all. They have it all. And so, you know, I'm expecting a lot of good stuff to happen. And, you know, my accountability measure is going to be pretty high.
Great. Well, I think we have time for a couple of questions. There's mics scattered around the room. If anybody wants to fire something at Mitch, feel free to grab a mic.
Don't be shy.
Got one up there?
You can even be rude.
Hi.
Hey.
Hi, Mayor Landrieu. Thanks for coming.
How are you?
I'm up here.
I see you.
I've spent a lot of time in New Orleans over the past 30 years, and I feel like that New Orleans and Durham share a problem, and that is the success that has been happening in New Orleans the last 5-7 years. It's happening here, too, but there are a lot of people that are getting pushed out or left behind from that success. Housing prices in New Orleans and in Durham skyrocketing. What are you doing, or what kind of creative, innovative ideas do you have to try to take care of the people that were there and that made particularly New Orleans the cool place it is, but might not be able to be there much longer?
Yeah, that's a, let me kind of put this question into context for you. I don't want to sound cold, but it's a good problem to have. So remember I told you New Orleans, before Katrina, was a descending city. Trying to find a place for people to live wasn't a problem because nobody wanted to live there. Went from 680,000 people to 460 before the night of the storm. And so it wasn't a problem. Housing was really low. Lots of people lived there, whoever wanted to, and the economy was going, you know. Now the city's hot. part of the city, a good part of the city, is really hot. Like, if you're in the real estate business right now or you want to sell your house, great time to be in New Orleans. Not so much if you're an hourly employee. So you see this kind of happening. It's really kind of mostly manifest on the front page of the paper in San Francisco with Silicon Valley. You see that there, and you see this as more people are moving into cities. And by the way, demography is destiny for the MPPs in the room. If you can figure out where people are moving to, you can almost predict what kind of problems they're going to have. So for all of the folks that are my age, you know, that moved out of the city and into the suburbs to raise your children, now that your kids are gone, if you can get them off your cell phone plan, that would be good too. You're starting to move back into the inner city, because inner cities are starting to become hubs of culture. You know, theater's coming back, art's coming back, music, food, all that kind of stuff. Well, what's happening is it's pushing people out, you know, that otherwise were living there because that's where cheap housing was. That's a pattern that's replicated itself over time. So in New Orleans, like everything, we try to get ahead of it. We try to see what's going on in other areas. We saw the San Francisco model. We looked at the Boston model. We looked at New York. There are generally three ways you can go. You can let the free market reign, and it is what it is. In Washington, D.C., for example, you know, around 14th Street, if you haven't been to Washington, 14th Street used to be really kind of rough. Now it's really nice and beautiful, and a lot of wealthy people came and invested their money, and a lot of poor people went out to, you know, Prince George's County and to other areas. The market just moves people out. Now, I don't know if they have any other zoning there, so I don't mean to bespeak what they're doing, but that's what it looks like happened there. In New York, the government came in with a heavy hand in the city and engaged in rent control. And so they did it that way. We kind of looked around and we thought Minneapolis had the best model. And they did it through zoning regulations by basically telling people that if you wanted to come into an area and you wanted to build something that wasn't already allowed by the zoning code, I mean, like if you needed any variance whatsoever, you had to start meeting affordable housing, you know, goals. If you wanted a pilot, a payment in lieu of taxes, or you wanted some kind of industrial tax exemption break, anything that required us to say yes to you, then you had to do what we needed, and we would kind of do a hybrid between the private and the public sector. So we did that. As Sean said earlier, one of the really beautiful successes is what used to be called housing projects, really dense, focused, heavy concentration of lots of people who were poor, high murder rates, high poverty. We crashed them all to the ground. And we then built back up mixed-use facilities, and they're beautiful. And literally, I don't want to say this universally, but almost everybody that lives there is thrilled with what they have now versus what they had before. Now, it's not everything that you need, but it's better. And then on top of that, we're trying to incent through community-developed block grant monies and all kind of fair housing monies the development of single-family dwellings using second mortgages and things of that nature in neighborhoods who produce affordable housing. But it's going to continue to be a challenge. It is a problem, but it is a much better problem to have than blight. And on the blight issue, we had about 40,000 blighted properties. We're now down to about 20. We've cut it in half because we've really worked hard about getting those back into commerce. But we're messing with both of those things at one time, and we're trying. And I think we're doing all right.
All right, we got time for one more over here.
Hi, Mayor, thank you for your presentation, your transparency in your presentation. I really enjoyed and appreciate your comments around preventive. There's a program called the Rites of Passage Program that works with young African-American males. How do you see these preventive programs, educational institutions, businesses, and government working together to bring more support into poverty-stricken neighborhoods?
Paul Ryan has talked a lot about a poverty agenda. Now, Paul Ryan's a disciple of Jack Kemp, I'm told, and that's good. Jack Kemp was one of the few Republicans that actually thought about urban issues way back when, and he never, ever kind of came into having the power to do what he wanted. Sean shares this view with me. When Sean and I were in the legislature, it was a very eclectic place, and there were a lot of very conservative people. I mean, as conservative as anybody in this room would know, we had them. And we would go to lunch pretty often with a guy named Pepe Bruno or Woody Jenkins. These guys are to the right as far as you can get. You can't get any further than them, although I'm starting to wonder if there's some people that can. But, You know, one of the things we thought about and turned out to be true, because I tell you, we were reformers, we weren't really kind of ideologically bent, is if you put us in the room with anybody that really wanted to solve a problem, we'd come out with an answer. That was almost universally true. If you wanted to solve the problem, as opposed to gain political uphold or get elected next time, you can solve the problem. And on this issue, I'm really encouraged by what Paul Ryan has said. I want to see what he's going to do. But if he really thinks that people should have access to health care, if he really believes that he wants to lift people out of poverty, he's going to find a really open and willing group of people in Congress that will help him get there. What doesn't work is, you know what, on the federal level, that's not our responsibility, and we solve the problem by pushing it down to the states. That's a fade. That's throwing shade on something. That doesn't work. So if they want to do that, they're going to find a lot of people that are going to say, okay, well, there are 15 different ways to fix, you know, to provide affordable housing or to help create job training or to create health care or to make sure that the criminal justice system works. As long as at the end of the day, your goal is to take, in your instance, of your example, that young African-American man and take him from a place of despair and no hope into a place of opportunity. Now, I can tell you this. Take this to the bank. My kids in my city are as smart as anybody else in America. And when they have taken advantage of this education reform, we took kids that would be on the street, and they are now gone to the best colleges in America because they were given a chance. And they were given teachers, and they were given the same sustenance, and they were given the same love, and they were given the same support. And almost always, they competed on a level that was commensurate with their talent, almost always. So this notion that kids can't learn or that you have to have a perfect family to learn, it's better to have that, is not true. And New Orleans is proof positive that if you give kids the same opportunities and you give them the same support, they're gonna step up to the plate and they're gonna do well, and we can prove it.
Great stuff. Hey, y'all, thanks for coming. Look, we're gonna have a reception upstairs. Feel free to come on up and mingle with the mayor and Mr. Mayor, Mitch, seatmate, thanks for coming.
John, thank you.